Welcome everybody to Kitchen Table Classroom. Thanks so much for joining us. My name is Kate Schutz. I'm with the Calgary Public Library, work as a service design lead. We're very happy to have you joining us virtually. And we would like to acknowledge that our homes and our libraries and our schools are located on the traditional territories of the Indigenous people of Alberta. And so to welcome you today, I'd like to share with you our children's land acknowledgement from Calgary Public Library, and it has actions. So you're welcome to join me if you like. We begin with seven. Today we acknowledge our Treaty 7 friends, where the Blackfoot meet on Elbows Bend. Soon came the Tsutina from the Beaver Clan and the Ahe Nakoda of the mountain lands. Last but not least, the Métis from Region 3. We are all treaty people here in Calgary.
Thanks, Kate. My name is Emily. I am a librarian with the Edmonton Public Library, and I'd also like to share a land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that we are on Treaty 6 territory, a traditional meeting grounds, gathering place, and traveling route to the Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, Dene, and Nakota Sioux. We acknowledge all the many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit whose footsteps have marked these lands for centuries.
Thank you, Emily. So those of you who are joining us for the first time, Kitchen Table Classroom is a partnership between Edmonton Public Library and Calgary Public Library. So whether your child is in school online this year or you're looking to support their schoolwork, this series is designed to support the learning that happens at home. Today's session is really exciting. It's the first in a mini series that we're going to be doing on diverse and inclusive children's books. We wanted to share Indigenous authored and Indigenous illustrated books with you in honor of National Indigenous History Month. We hope that the information we share will be helpful for the conversations your families and classrooms may be having, especially around the recent news stories exposing more of the tragic truth of residential schools in our country.
Thank you. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker. With roots in St. Francis Xavier, Red River area of Manitoba, and St. Paul de Métis, Colette Poitras now spends time between Elk Point and Edmonton, Alberta. Her father brought her up to be proudly Métis, and she is happy to pass down the knowledge and culture to her two remarkable daughters. She has served as a committee member of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee, a subcommittee of the Canadian Federation of Libraries Association, as well as the chair of the subsequently formed Indigenous Matters Committee. She writes children's books reviews for the Canadian Children's Book Center and Quill and Choir, and currently serves as a juror for the TD Canadian Children's Literature Award. She has written about the Métis experience in We Remember the Coming of the White Man, has edited the book Restoring the History of St. Paul de Métis, and is the project coordinator for Stories of Métis Women, Tales My Cook'em Told Me, which is coming in August 2021. Colette is a champion of the International Board on Books for Young People from C2C Indigenous Picture Book Collection, and also proudly serves as the chair for the 2021 update of From Sea to Sea. For formal education, she has a Bachelor of Arts degree and a Master's degree in Library and Information Science, and was represented with a very prestigious award, Library Journal Movers and Shakers Award, for her work in Indigenous Library Service in 2017. In her day job, she is the Manager of Indigenous Public Library Outreach for the Public Library Services Branch within the Ministry of Municipal Affairs for the Government of Alberta. She believes strongly in inclusive literature for children and the role that libraries play in the community and child development. Welcome, Colette. We are so happy to have you here, and I will turn things over to you.
Thank you so much. I'm going to share my screen. So I also want to just position myself, who I am, where I come from, why I'm doing this session. So I am a citizen, Limichifnia. I'm a citizen of the Métis Nation. You'll see in this map, there's a picture, and in the very center of it is a fellow named Louis Riel. And to our left, two seats to our left, or to what would be Louis Riel's right, is my great-great-grandfather, Pierre Poitras. So yeah, Louis Riel. So prior to that provisional government, probably by close to 100 years, the Métis had gathered. And so my ancestors, the mothers were First Nations. I have Cree and Soto grandmothers and a European, French and Scottish forefathers. And they created a nation well before Canada started with all of the markers of a nation. So we have our own sense of our own laws, our own governance, our own language, our own music, our own clothing, and all of those things again, and an extensive kinship network that extends throughout the prairies. So after 1869, 1870, which was when the Red River Resistance happened, the government of Manitoba actually entered Confederation. It was based on what was written up by Louis Riel's provisional government. However, that didn't work out, even though they negotiated successfully to join the Canadians' Dominion of Canada. There was a reign of terror, and basically the Métis were driven out of the Red River area at that time. So my ancestor that I've pointed out there, he ended up getting actually beaten severely. And him and his son, my great-great-grandfather, Francois, came to Duhamel, the Duhamel area. On my dad's maternal side, Laurent Garneau also was a captain of Louis Riel's, and he also fled the Red River and came to Edmonton. I had uncles and aunts. I had relatives that went to Batoche, Saskatchewan. And in 1885, there was the Northwest Resistance. And after that, Métis were persona non grata. Métis ended up being the road allowance people. There was no kind of land. There was nowhere for people to go. They got driven out of Edmonton and the Camrose area. So my family ended up going to St. Paul de Métis. It was a at the time acknowledged as a reserve established by Father Lacombe. After amount of time, French settlers actually from Quebec came in and settled that area. So we ended up getting driven out. And my family ended up just north of now, north of Old Point. My dad was born at home in the Moose Hills, and he has taught me what being Métis is. So my family ancestors, again, to situate me, my direct ancestors are from the Poitras, Garneau, Boudreau, Desjarlais, Thomas Taylor, St. Denis, Aubuchon, and Grant families. And if there are any Métis people in the audience at all, chances are we're connected somehow down the line. So another thing I really want to do to situate this session, everyone that's come is probably fully aware of this, but just to kind of, again, position it, is just how important reading is for children, right? And on their brain development, there could be almost like nothing more positive you can do with children than to sit and read a story. They learn through, there's knowledge transmission, there's bonding. And what is in clinical psychology, children's psychology terms, serve in return. So as I read to a small child, the child's listening and the child's responding by pointing at the fingers or by asking, pointing at the picture, or by asking follow-up questions. And it's these positive interactions between young children and their caregivers that really starts to create and build that architecture of the brain. And without that, without that safe environment that you're creating, it really, that empowers children to learn, right? Like, and they learn about the world. They learn about, you're setting children up by doing these things for social, emotional, intellectual intelligence. It creates empathy. It creates this relationship building skill. There's nothing better, I don't think, that you can do to ground a child when they're in these formative years. And conversely, if the children don't have that, if they if they're in an environment that is traumatic or toxic, it makes it really hard to learn. So I want you to just kind of reflect on that as I talk about, I'm not going to get into great detail about Indigenous history, but all of those impacts of colonization, of the laws that were put in place under the Indian Act and of residential schools and of the 60 scoop and child apprehension and the trauma that has caused. So if you're in the care of, or if you have children in your care, like just think about that and all of the positive things that you can do as a caregiver to create a safe space for children to read. I do have a couple of links here that I'd recommend if you want more information. Public Library Services Branch held a Little Ones in Library Symposium that actually talked about all of these kind of things at length and are really quite interesting and impactful. Another thing I want to discuss is diversity and how important diversity is for, again, when little guys are learning about the world. Now's the time to kind of talk about empathy and acceptance, and having diverse books on your shelf is a wonderful way to start, I think. As noted, it showcases, highlights, and respects the differences and facets of identities of those that populate the world of the world around the child. We want to reflect that by what's on the bookshelf. And I'll note something that's not listed here, but something that often is with diversity and inclusion is equity. And equity is really important at creating balance, right? Up until now, there's been a dearth of Indigenous or certainly positive Indigenous materials for children. If there were mentions of Indigenous peoples in books, often they would be stereotyped or there would be racist depictions. So now that we actually have kind of a renaissance of publishing, we have those Indigenous materials that are readily available. In my mind, to create equity, we really want to kind of highlight those. We want to bring them out and maybe read them a little more than other books, just to create that, again, that equity and balance. By doing all of these, you are creating a sense of inclusion by celebrating people's differences, by showing representation within the books. Children are seeing themselves reflected in these books. It's making them feel welcome. And I think that's really important to teach tolerance and empathy and honestly even critical thinking skills. Children are learning social and emotional learning, problem solving, to know that not everybody has the same experience as they do. It really gets children thinking about the way others live their life and understanding, and it's fine and we can all get along and we can celebrate that. I will note, just from a personal standpoint, years ago, I thought it was really important to say, you know, all human beings, of course, all human beings matter, and colorblind is beautiful. We shouldn't even notice the differences. But I've since learned that differences are what makes us special. So I'm very white coated as a Métis person. My brother isn't. My brother is more kind of looks more Indigenous. We're both just as important, and I think we both need to see our experiences reflected in materials, right? Highlight them and celebrate the differences. And what this all leads into, it's a continuum. And I will note that you need to be quite purposeful and deliberate when you're doing your collecting of books or deciding what you're going to read to make these titles more accessible to the little ones and to deliberately try and create an equity in what children are seeing. And what that means is belonging, right? All children are feeling valued, and in turn they learn and thrive. Other children, let's say non-Indigenous children, reading about Indigenous children, learn the value of getting along with each other, learning about empathy and about the fact that the world is reflected in these titles that we're choosing. And I really like that that statement at the bottom, that quote, diversity is having a seat at the table, inclusion is having a voice, and belonging is having that voice be heard. And ultimately, if we can do that, the world's our oyster. Children will be feeling safe. They'll feel like they can learn. So before we go more into specifically Indigenous titles, I thought I would kind of give a few definitions that I might use that sometimes people aren't clear on what different definitions mean, if they mean the same thing or if they mean different things. So one thing I'll hazard a warning, try not to use the term Indian. It is problematic. Especially within Canada, it's a misnomer. Christopher Columbus got lost, and that doesn't mean that, you know, people's identities needed to change from that. You will find that in the States, sometimes they still use that terminology. And of course, for adult materials, it's still a legal term entrenched in the Indian Act. So in those circumstances, it is appropriate. But for children's books, I would try to avoid titles that use that term. They may be dated. Aboriginal is also a legal term. It's enshrined in the 1982 Constitution. And it's an umbrella term for all of the nations, Indigenous nations within Canada. I specifically actually don't care for that term. It's just a preference. You may find people that like that term better. But linguistically, it's been explained to me that the prefix ab means to take away, not. So if you put that with original, it means not original. So it's not, I prefer the term, the next term there is Indigenous. And that also is an umbrella term for all First Nations, Métis, and Inuit. In Canada, it's a term for Indigenous people throughout the world, used legally by the United Nations and entrenched in the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People. And it really means, again, from the land, native to the land. So I really like that because I think as Indigenous people, we are grounded in our surroundings and in the land. FNMI, it's pretty obvious, but it's an acronym for First Nations, Métis, and Inuit. First Nations, there are many, many nations. So it's almost an umbrella term as well. There are, I think there are 634 sovereign First Nations within the country of Canada. So, you know, like that's a huge amount of different First Nations. And then when you have Métis people and Inuit are the people from the north, of course, the circumpolar regions, not just Canada, but, you know, if you can try and identify people or by their nation, I think that's the most respectful. Ask people what they prefer. You can say, like I say, I'm Indigenous, but I'm specifically Métis. That's my nation. So. So just in your travels or when you're examining books, like what nation is being highlighted here. Another thing I want to point out just is what the state is now of a diversity in children's books. So here's a great graphic that kind of shows it from 2018. It's from the Cooperative Children's Book Center. And you'll see that in the graphic, 50% of the children that are depicted in picture books published in 2018 are white. So you see the little blonde boy, he has all of those mirrors that are reflecting his life, his experiences, his look. And then you move to the side and you see 27% of animals are depicted as the kind of the primary character in children's books and his mirrors getting a little. As we move to the left, 10% African or African-American children are seeing themselves reflected in the books, 7% Asian Pacific Islander, Asian Pacific American, 5% Latinx, and you'll see the mirrors are getting progressively smaller until finally you get a little tiny compact, which reflects the child's experience, the First Nations child's experience, and it's only 23 books out of all of the books that have been published in 2018. And it has been noted, Debbie Reese does a session, and I'll explain a little more about Debbie Reese. But just because the main character is Indigenous doesn't mean that the book is actually, the depictions are accurate either. So out of that 23 books, there may only be 18 that actually portray Indigenous children in an accurate way. So I mentioned Debbie Reese. I think she is a fantastic resource. If you're confused about materials, if you've gotten a book and you're not sure if it's, you know, a quality book or not, I would recommend going to her American Indians in Children's Literature blog. And she is from the States, so that's why she uses that terminology. She's an American scholar, but she has great lists of what's recommended, of what is not. And I think she's kind of the preeminent voice in Indigenous children's literature, so you may want to check her out. In addition to that, a series I'd recommend, she was actually the keynote for it. It's called Indigenous Voices, Authentic Literature in the Classroom and Library. A link to that. And it's got her doing a keynote speaking about kind of the same things I am about the lack of representation, basically, in children's literature and Indigenous children's literature. And then there are guests that are Indigenous creators from the States that speak to their own experiences and writing their own books. So, and just in addition to that, there's also a book coming out called Reading and Teaching with Diverse Nonfiction Children's Books. And it should be out anytime. I recommend kind of taking a look at that if you can as well. So I want to talk about looking at critically at Indigenous children's literature and what makes quality Indigenous children's literature. One of the first things that I like to do is or look at is, are the creators Indigenous? Do they have connections with their community? If not, have they done meaningful consultation with Indigenous peoples? And this is important. And I know some people, there's an argument, oh, we can't ask. We can't ask what nation they're from, or it might be rude, or it's not. Like, that's how come I started actually my quite long introduction to whom I am and how I fit my kinship ties. That's how, certainly as Métis people, we identify each other. Who are you? What's your Métis name? Who are your family? And then we figure out how we fit in together. So this isn't something that's rude. And I think it's completely appropriate that you would see if the creators are creating that authenticity in the titles. And something to watch for, I had noticed there's well over 600 different nations in Canada alone. Watch for material like books that kind of have this pan-Indigenous feel. So if they're talking about totem poles and then they're talking about dream catchers and someone's playing a flute somewhere, like maybe this isn't legit. Maybe they're not speaking on behalf of their nation, because no one can. It's kind of saying like, oh, a European book. Well, what kind of book? An Irish book, an English book, you know, a Polish book. It's the same thing. There are tons of different nations, and people, authenticity means that you're speaking about your own stories. Another thing I just want to note is don't make presumptions or stereotypes about what the Indigenous experience is. Realize that not all Indigenous people live on reserve. Almost half of First Nations people live off reserve. Métis settlements, only 5% of Métis people live in settlements. So the vast majority of Indigenous people actually within the province are urban and have urban experiences. So that is just as much the Indigenous experience as living on a reserve. And note that because of colonization, many people are trying to regain their own language, culture, and ceremony. So at one point, the Indian Act actually barred and outlawed ceremony for Indigenous people. Language, if you went to residential school, you were severed of that language. You would get into trouble if you spoke your language, right? The culture, they would cut your hair at residential school. So that was kind of a legal thing. So, and then not to mention the 60s scoop apprehension, where you were really encouraged not to be proud of who you were or know your roots. So just to acknowledge that not everyone is an expert in their own history and culture, not everyone's going to know. They're going to be interested, children are going to be interested in these stories, Indigenous children just as much as non-Indigenous children, to learn these things. And, you know, just a warning not to kind of tokenize if there's if you have Indigenous children or adults, like they may not be able to speak to you. You can't say, well, little Johnny, can you tell us all about this culture? Because they may not be able to. They're learning as well. Or they may, but don't make a presumption. And finally, we're not just a historic people. I think that's really important too. A lot of people, you know, if you think about Cree people, well, where's your teepee? You know, how come you're not hunting buffalo? Or do we even do that anymore? Lots of Indigenous people are just living their best life, getting their Starbucks, you know, hopping on their iPad to check something out, to update their social media accounts, their TikTok. And we just need to think that all of these things are legitimately and authentic, right? And again, Indigenous children need to see mentors and role models in their books, just as much as non-Indigenous people need to see like these contemporary people in the books. And titles by Richard Van Camp, Monique Grace Smith, Julie Flett, all wonderful titles to read that are contemporary and not historic. I was going to play, it's a bit long though, so I won't, but I do recommend a video that Monique Grace Smith put to YouTube, and it is on how to support families and educators talking about residential schools with small children, as well as resources for anyone, for older people as well. So if you have time, check that out, as well as David Robertson has a fantastic list of great books that speak to the residential school experience. So I'm circling back, I'll circle back a few times, but as much as you teach about trauma and as much trauma as there is in Indigenous communities or have been, really by the impacts of colonization, I think it's really important, if the handle here of Tipler teaches, to remember to teach Indigenous brilliance and success as much as you teach Indigenous suffering and trauma. I think that's really important to have, again, a balanced collection. If you're going to read one, please try and follow up the next day with, you know, if you're going to read like a traumatic kind of story about residential schools, maybe you could read a cultural story or a historic story and then read a contemporary story. And I just want to note too, as a librarian, that, you know, whether, like, I'm a parent and I have tons of books that I had for my kids when they were little, as teachers who may have a classroom library or a school library or for public libraries, books are not sacred. If they're harmful, if they're outdated, and if they have stereotypes, particularly children's books, we're not talking about archives, we're not talking about adult materials, we're talking about children. You can weed. If they're old and if they're hurtful or harmful to children, weed them, throw them out. Debbie Rees, in that great video series that I had mentioned, she had a quote that really struck with me, where she said, books aren't sacred, but children are. So we want to make sure that we're not harming children by reading titles that are old and have stereotypes in them. So all of that, it sounds like a tremendous amount of work. You have to vet through who these authors are. You have to see if their experiences are authentic. Like, that's a lot of work. I'm tasking me with a lot. What I'd recommend is the fact that myself, a group of people, Indigenous librarians, non-Indigenous librarians, Indigenous authors, and non-Indigenous authors, have actually curated collections for children's books that we think are absolutely fantastic. So the one to my left is From Sea to Sea to Sea, and that's the original through the International Board on Books for Young People, IBBY Canada's collection of the top 100 best picture books published prior to 2018. And it's a great book. You'll see Julie Flith's beautiful illustration on that. On the other side is Maya McKibben from Swift Fox All Along. And that catalog is the updated version, basically 2018 to 2021. And in the titles, you have the list here, you have the creators, their specific nations are listed. So you know exactly what nation is being represented in the story. You have a summary, you have when it was published. So I think there's a lot of good information basically at your fingertips. If they're digital catalogs, you go to that site and you can bring up, do I want to speak about residential schools to my kids, and then read the summaries. And I think that really hopefully makes your life a lot easier, being able to do that. When We Are Alone is a beautiful, beautiful story introducing children in a gentle way to residential schools, as is The Train. I Am Not a Number is a little more specific about what happened to Jenny K. Dupuis' grandmother when she went to a residential school. And you'll see here The Train was in the 2021 updated edition. When We Were Alone and I Am Not a Number was in the original collection. Included in the collection is our cultural stories, history, and life. They are very, very important, particularly if people haven't heard these stories, and because of the Indian Act not allowing people to practice their ceremony or speak their language, I think this is also very valuable. I have just a few examples here, language titles about honoring the buffalo and how people survived. And I'll say it, I'm not supposed to, it's summertime. In fact, it's very warm out there. These are normally winter stories. With Saki Duck, this one, and they're basically, they tell through the stories, you learn lessons, right? For a Cree and Métis, there were lessons embedded in these stories through this trickster. I noted before how important contemporary stories are, as well as a balance. And again, these are just people living their best life. And I think that both Indigenous kids and non-Indigenous kids deserve to see Indigenous people just living their best life. And in all of these are generally really tie or show that Indigenous worldview, that connection to the land, the connection to your kin, the connection to your relatives, meaning the animals and the water, as well as the people, right? Like it really demonstrates a worldview. So Sky Sisters is an older book now. It's 21 years old. I have a special relationship with that book. I was on vacation with my kids. They were small. I had no money. I was a young mother, but I bought that book on the spot when I saw it, because I'd never prior to that, never saw a book that reflected young Indigenous girls just out playing in the snow, watching the Northern Lights. And for me, it was very impactful when I saw that, and very memorable. And I read that to my children, and I've kept that book because I want to read it to my grandchildren. You'll see that was from the original collection. The Girl and the Wolf and Birdsong are from the newly updated catalog. And The Girl and the Wolf is just wonderful as well. Completely encapsulates an Indigenous worldview when it's basically a spin on Little Red Riding Hood. I have, you know, another one, Oasis in the World Famous Bannock. Dallas Hunt, same idea. Birdsong is just a beautiful way. Again, just Indigenous people living their best life. Tells the story of an intergenerational friendships and caring for others. For graphic novels, if you have older children or, you know, or more advanced readers, The Outside Circle by Patty Labick and Benson is fantastic for encapsulating. Actually, it's a really good, quick read that teaches you basically all about colonization in one graphic novel. This Place, 150 Years Retold, another one, it's an anthology with a whole bunch of fantastic creators, both illustrators and authors, which tell, it's a continuum of stories from early days to Indigenous futurisms. And it really packs a punch in that, in those few pages. It's quite thick. Sugar Falls by David Robertson, if you want something a little older to teach kids about residential school, or the Reckoner series by David Robertson as well, which is kind of a action, you know, fantasy series of graphic novels. A Girl Called Echo by Katrina Vermette. I really like that for teaching the Métis story in a graphic novel as well. And one I read actually recently was Jojo Macoun. Series by Dawn Quigley, and it's just about a young girl. She's like Junie B. Jones. She's just precocious, and she's getting into trouble, and she's just living her best life. And she's Ojibwe, and that's just kind of the thing. She teaches a little bit of culture, and it's just her worldview that comes out, and it's very clever, and it's a fun story. So I recommend that as well. So where do you get these stories? Go to your library. Certainly you can go to bookstores as well. I mean, Calgary Public Library is doing fantastic Indigenous initiatives. They have their Indigenous Language Resource Center, Edmonton Public as well. Great things happening there. I've been working with them on their Voices of a Miskwichi digital platform, which is now evolving into Voices of the Land. So I encourage you to check that out as well. And that's Indigenous people uploading their own stories. So you can hear the stories directly from Indigenous people and see the pictures and watch the videos, as well as the Prairie Indigenous ebook collection, which is available through your library catalog indeed as well. And they have titles that you can check out simultaneously. So if you want to have a book club discussion, up to 50 people can check the title out at once. And what better way to teach your children? I mean, reading a story is absolutely the best, but also just being informed yourself. So when they ask questions, when they get a little bigger and they ask questions, then you can be prepared to answer them in a sensitive way, because you're their role models, you're their mentors. So reading books by Richard Wagamese and Michelle Good and Katrina Vermette and Drew Hayden Taylor and Marilyn Dumont and Jesse Thistle, among many, many others, to inform yourself is one of the best things that you can do. I'm just going to kind of finish on, again, like informing yourself, I think is super important. Partaking in the library, there's elders that come to the library, there's opportunity to speak to the elders, that's the best. Like that, the elders are the library, right? Like they are their nation's library, they hold the knowledge. And most elders I've ever met are happy to share if you approach them in a good way. Attend powwows, go to Métis cultural events, go to Native friendship centers in your community that are offering hosting events. Immerse yourself, learn by doing as well, and then take the MOOC, the Indigenous Canada MOOC. I know the lead instructor, Paul Garrow, he'll be happy to answer any of the questions that you might have if you sign up. You can take it online for free. It's 12 modules. You can get a certificate or you can take it for university credit. So yeah, there's all sorts of opportunities, both for your children as well as for yourself, to immerse yourself in this beautiful world and learn all of this great knowledge. So with that, I'll say thank you, Marcy. Hi, hi. Happy to answer any questions tonight. My email is there as well. So if you want to contact me after the fact, I'm more than happy to chat with you. Thanks so much.